Irate at Iran. Is that the right move for the USA? And the truth in the FISA application, which side owns it? Nina Turner and Rick Santorum are here for what should be a great debate. Let's start with Iran. Rick, you like the move by the president, do you?
I do. Anything that that shows that we stand with the people of Iran who hate their leadership, who are being oppressed by the leadership. If you look at Mike Pompeo's speech yesterday at the Reagan Library, it was brilliant. He laid out the tremendous scourge that this regime is to their people, and how Khomeini, the Ayatollah. He has a $95 billion hedge fund. I mean, you have Lauren Johnny, the head of judicial, he has a $300 million estate. I mean, these folks are getting rich. They're oppressing their people. They're persecuting and killing their people. They're oppressing women. You want to talk about women really being oppressed? It's not Saudi Arabia. It's Iran. And the people hate the regime. So when the United States stands up and calls out the regime for what they are, that's a good thing for us.
You think that's what Trump was doing, Nina?
Not at all. I mean, I think it's yet another distraction, and the president certainly can take a page out of President Teddy Roosevelt's book, which is to speak softly and carry a big stick. There was no need to try to pick a fight here. We are a hegemon nation, and so we don't have to get up in arms like that and on every single situation. But the president doesn't know how to speak softly and carry the big stick. He has to continue to protest. And to me, as far as I'm concerned, this is nothing more than a distraction to try to amp up Iran. And just to have Chris, just a cavalier attitude about war itself really does not make a whole lot of sense. And the threats that he has given, war is serious. Whether it's Iran or Russia or any other country, it is really, really a serious matter. And so we should not play games with it. The president of the United States should not play games with it. And let us not forget that we are the only nation that in war that dropped a nuclear bomb on other nations, you know, Hiroshima and Nagasaki. So it doesn't make a whole lot of sense here for the president to play games with this.
Well, in terms of what is happening right now, we have heard some of the language before with North Korea. Fair point. However, in both cases, the president never really went after the kinds of oppression you're talking about, Rick. I have the transcript of the Secretary of State speech. You're correct about what Pompeo did, but that's not what Trump was talking about. He just seemed to be chest bumping with Rouhani, didn't he?
Well, he was responding. I mean, it's a Twitter response. I mean, he was responding to Rouhani, and I think he did so very forcefully.
Sure.
And he did so right on the heels of a speech by his Secretary of State, which I think laid out very clearly the policies of this administration.
Why now?
Hopefully he wanted to bring attention to a story that wasn't getting much
attention.
Why
didn't he mention the people and the oppression and the women and the we're not going to stand for it? How come he didn't say
that?
Well,
I think, you know, Donald Trump is a man that likes to create controversy. And I think what he knew he would do if he tweeted that is that people would all of a sudden start talking about Iran. And you couldn't help talk about Iran and not talk about what the Secretary of State
said
yesterday.
Can't talk about Iran and not talk about Russia. And that's what I think is going on here. I think the president sees an opportunity here. There's no question that you're right about Iran being an oppressive regime, one of many around the world. But he's picking this one. And he's picking it right now at a time that certainly he wants to distract from all this Russia drama, which won't happen, not on this show. We're going to discuss it in just a second. But the only person that he probably can turn to for help with Iran right now is Russia. What a coincidence.
Well, I would just say that I don't think Russia has really been in the business of helping us with any.
No, but that's
their,
what they came to the table
allies.
With in Syria. That's supposedly what Russia
didn't.
Has been offering.
Well,
help you with Iran. We can help you with where they are. Why did he meet with Benjamin Netanyahu? We can help you with where Iran is. We know where they are on the border there. This is one of the things they're offering. Interesting timing, no?
Well, all I can say is they were going to help us with Syria and Assad, and they didn't. We signed a chemical deal that was.
And they were
going to
help us with North Korea. And the first
chance
they had, they rooked us at the UN.
So,
which, Nina, let's bounce it back to you. Which raises the specter of what the president thinks is true and what winds up happening in reality don't always meet on international affairs.
Most often it doesn't meet on international affairs, and the president knows exactly what he is doing. He is really the master of distraction. Whenever he gets tangled up any kind of way, this is what he does. He deflects, he deflects, he deflects. And he's going to continue to do that. Again, foreign affairs, I mean, domestic issues, vitally important. Foreign affairs, vitally important. And the president goes it alone a lot, Chris. He doesn't even seek the advice of his foreign policy experts before he goes out like a five-year-old and pulls everybody into his web. See, the difference between him running his companies is that being the president of the United States of America, there's so much at stake, both here at home and also with foreign policy, our geopolitical partners in the world. He's pulling everybody into this, and he needs to take his statements and his tweets a little more seriously and to understand that there are serious consequences attached to the actions and the moves that he makes and also his tweets.
Well, while true, he is the president. Rick, go ahead.
One comment there is that may be true on occasion. I wouldn't disagree that he's sometimes out of sync with his policy team. He is not out of sync with his policy team on this one. John Bolton is as tough on Iran as a Mike
Pompeo. But John Bolton, I mean,
they are all
come on,
in
Senator.
Sync with the president.
John Bolton is a war
hawk. Iran is a major threat and somebody that, if we stand up with the people of Iran, which is what Secretary Pompeo was very clear about, that maybe changes can occur.
All right. So, look. He has to, as president, get deference to his own style and his own choices, and we'll see how they play out, and he will be judged by many different sectors of society.
But Chris, he can stand with the people of Iran, but not stand with the people of the United States of America, not even his own intelligence community that talked about Russia and what they did in the 2016
Well, I get your criticism,
election.
And that takes us to our next topic that I want to deal with quickly here. Rick, he can feel whatever he wants, but what was released does not give him the factual ability to say it was all about the dossier. You know that, Rick. You know that what was released with the FISA application, we now know dispositively it wasn't just the dossier, and that dossier was explained for what it was. So for him to say otherwise is just not true.
Well, I think the point is that what you say, it wasn't just the dossier. So even those who look at it and look at the FISA application and say, well, it certainly was about the dossier, but you're right. It wasn't just about the dossier.
But he suggests it was all about the dossier, and that's demonstrably false. Why do that?
Well, because I think that there's no question that that was a major piece of
this application. But it wasn't the only thing. And they had a whole other factual basis. There are dozens and dozens of pages that are redacted that weren't about the dossier. That's just the truth.
Yeah, the reason he's talking about it is because the dossier is false. There's nothing in that dossier.
That's not true. There are things in it that were not substantiated, and there are things in it that were. Again, why be wholesale in everything? Why can't anybody be damn subtle about anything? Why can't it be you're only kind of right about part of it? The whole thing isn't a hoax. They attacked the campaign. They meant to do it. They're still doing it now. They want to do it next time. You've done nothing to stop it. And there is no proof at this point that anybody in the Trump campaign had anything to do with it. Why can't he just say that?
Well, I mean, are you asking Donald Trump to be nuanced?
That's pretty obvious. If I can do it, he can do it, Rick. Well, it's not subtle. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I think he has a point to make, and he's making his point. I would agree with you that it is not completely accurate, but he's going to continue to make his point. I don't think he's going to be
nuanced. I'm glad the senator is agreeing. I mean, not just nuance. If he can just tell the truth from time to time, that would be a great start.
Well, especially on that, because it matters. It's dividing this country, and that's why we discuss it on the show the way we do. And I appreciate the efforts of both of you on a Monday evening. Thank you to you both. Nina Turner,
Chris.
Rick Santorum.